right, so I was asked to talk a little bit about immunotherapy, which I think is very hyped in the sort of both scientific and the lay press. And so I thought we would talk a little bit about what immunotherapy is and should it and does it apply to NETs. So first, that requires understanding a little bit about your immune system. So this is, I promise, I only have like one slide or two on the science of the immune system. So just a reminder for everybody, the key cells in your immune system include B cells, which are a type of white blood cell that makes antibodies, which bind to specific proteins or antigens. There are also T cells, which are another type of white blood cell that can kill cells recognized as foreign. So ideally, we'd like T cells to recognize cancer cells. Dendritic cells help teach the T cells, and macrophages are the garbage trucks of the immune system. I have here just a description on the bottom of one form of immunotherapy. We'll talk about some of the others, but checkpoint inhibitors, one, for example, is Keytruda, which is sort of advertised broadly. There are many others, but checkpoint inhibitors are drugs that block proteins made by T cells and some cancer cells, and when blocked, the stop sign for the immune system is removed. So essentially, then your immune system can recognize the cancer as being foreign. We'll talk a little bit more about that. So in 2013, cancer immunotherapy was designated by Science Magazine as the breakthrough of the year. So it was really, it's been in the last now, I guess, 6 years that we've seen an explosion of immunotherapy. These fall primarily into three main categories. So one are these checkpoint modulators that I just mentioned that help essentially release a stop sign to allow your body to recognize cancer cells as being foreign. There are vaccines, and there are cell-based therapies. So you've probably heard of CAR T. So those are manipulated T cells to help recognize the cancer as being foreign. So this is a busy slide, but the take home from this, these are really all of the immunotherapy agents that are FDA approved for various types of cancers. So we have, and many solid tumors and lymphomas and leukemias are represented. And immunotherapy is successful in some, but not all cancers, and notably neuroendocrine tumors are not currently on this list. And I think that it's important to remember that, you know, our therapies are really specific for specific cancer types. And immunotherapy, though, has been an incredible breakthrough, is really not a panacea for all. And we'll go into some of these details. So I'm going to start with small cell lung cancer. So we borrow some of how we treat high grade or grade 3 neuroendocrine carcinomas with how small cell lung cancers are treated. So there are some immunotherapies that are FDA approved for small cell lung cancer. So in the red box, carboplatin and etoposide, those are two chemotherapies, plus atezolizumab. Anything that ends in an AB, by the way, is an antibody. That's a little lingo for you. And so those chemotherapies plus atezolizumab are approved in small cell lung cancer. In addition, that's in this box here. In addition, nivolumab and ipilimumab and pembrolizumab, so all of these are antibodies. Those are also approved for small cell lung cancer. So can we extrapolate the success in small cell lung cancer to NETs or NECs? So the neuroendocrine tumors, which are the lower grade, or the neuroendocrine carcinomas, which are the higher grade. So this slide summarizes some of the clinical trials that have been conducted to date for neuroendocrine tumors and neuroendocrine carcinomas. And there are a number. The take home here, I'm going to put a box around RR means response rate. And I will be doing a clinical trials 101 talk in a little bit. So you're getting a preview from many of the speakers earlier on trials. But we'll dig into how to interpret trials in a bit. So the response rate means the shrinkage rate. So does this treatment shrink cancer? These response rates are very low, commonly between 5 and 10%. So that means that these single-agent immunotherapies for NETs does not shrink the cancer. The PFS is the progression-free survival, so that's the time it takes for a cancer to grow on a clinical trial. And these progression-free survival numbers are also quite low, meaning that immunotherapies in general don't do a very good job of slowing down the cancer. So the take-home is, at least right now, for what we know about immunotherapy and NETs, is that single-agent immunotherapy, so one drug at a time, generally results in low shrinkage rates and it has limited ability to delay progression. One of the most recent clinical trials in NETs and immunotherapy was called the DART trial, and it's an acronym for a very long title, so you can just call it the DART trial, but it's two immunotherapies, ipilimumab and nivolumab, and they have slightly different targets in the immune system. I'm going to teach you a little bit on how to interpret trials. So this was presented last year at the one of the big scientific oncology societies called AACR. And there was a whole lot of press that came out after that. I'm going to spend some time reading this. You can help me decide if you believe it or not. So this says, immune checkpoint inhibitor combination efficacious for patients with high-grade neuroendocrine carcinoma. A combination of two common immunotherapy drugs shrinks rare aggressive neuroendocrine tumors, according to new research. DART, success story in high-grade neuroendocrine carcinomas. So this is all just in the press. So based on this, you'd think, gosh, this is a blockbuster. I want this. All right, well, let's dig into some of the details. So this was a very small study. It was 32 patients. They all received the same medications. You can see here it was also a very heterogeneous group of neuroendocrine tumors. I think you've learned from some of the earlier presentations that we really are trying to be specific in how we study NETs, so studying the low grade and the high grade in separate studies, and studying lung and pancreatic NET in separate studies. So this is all mixed. There were 15 GI NETs, 6 lung, 6 other, and 5 unknown. And then there were 18 high grade, 10 intermediate grade, and 4 low grade. So these are the results. So their take home was that the response rate is high in the high grade neuroendocrine carcinomas. But if you dig into the details, there were only 3 patients with pulmonary high grade. So 2 out of the 3 responded. In the high grade GI neuroendocrine carcinomas, only 2 out of 8 responded. And no patients with the lower the intermediate grade tumors responded. So I'd like you to be cautious when you interpret some of the media, because I think that my take home from this is it's too early to extrapolate. I think it's encouraging. We'll talk a little bit more about what trials ultimately lead to FDA approvals, but I'm not using this data to change how I practice. And the rest of the physicians can tell me what they're doing. So immunotherapy side effects, I think, are also worth just briefly mentioning. I think a lot of people assume that because it's working on your immune system that it's, quote, natural. So these actually can have quite a few side effects, many of which can be serious. So they have, because it affects the immune system, immunotherapies can cause a whole bunch of inflammation. So words that end in the sort of phrase itis, so it can cause problems with the pituitary gland, like hypophysitis, or brain inflammation, encephalitis, cardiac inflammation, like myositis, bowel inflammation leading to diarrhea, enteritis. So it can cause these whole bunch of itises. And early recognition, evaluation, and treatment is critical. The treatment is usually pausing the drug and treating with anti-inflammatories like steroids. The time of onset can usually be between 6 to 12 weeks after initiation of therapy, but it can really happen at almost any point. I do want to just note 2 very early clinical trials. So these are phase one trials. We'll talk about the different phases, but phase one trials are looking at safety. That's their primary purpose. They're not intended to look at efficacy. So one trial is one I get asked about all the time because it got a lot of press. This is with Dr. Oberg in Sweden. And he has a clinical trial looking at an oncolytic virus vaccine. And I just got an update from him this week because I wanted to, everyone always asks, is that done yet? Can I get it? It's still in phase one, and they have been hampered by slow accrual. The Duet 1 clinical trial is a phase one trial that's being done internationally. We have it open at Stanford. This is another interesting approach to attacking the immune system where I need my hands for this one. So the somatostatin receptors you've just heard talked about because that's the target for PRRT. So think of the somatostatin receptor as the target. Well, this antibody grabs onto the somatostatin receptor and grabs onto a protein on the T cell and tries to bring those together to stimulate the immune system. So these are far off from ultimately making their way into practice, even if they are effective, but I think they're valuable to watch. And then what I've done here in these slides will be available later. I found two really wonderful patient resources on just immunotherapy in general, if you're interested in learning a little bit more. One is from the Society on Immunotherapy. So these are both professional societies and trusted resources. The other is cancer.net, which is in ASCO. The American Society of Clinical Oncology has a patient portal, and they have an immunotherapy website also. So both websites are listed. So take-home points, single-agent immunotherapy does not work yet for NECs or NETs. Early data for combination therapy, that was that DART trial. I think it's promising, but not yet ready for prime time. Immune-related side effects are important considerations and can be serious. And I'm eager to see more clinical trials looking at other combination therapies and ways to help manipulate NETs so that perhaps they can be amenable to immunotherapy, but we're not quite there yet. So that's it for now. Thank you.